name is Roberto Capodieci, and I will talk to you about decentralization and blockchain. Let me start with something we all can relate to. We all have been through the ICO craze. We all have heard that this startup pitch is going like, we are a customer-centric organization and we deliver the value of IoT, cloud, big data, machine learning, and artificial intelligence by using design thinking to drive digital transformation for blockchain-connected enterprise. Then you wonder what they do, and at the end it's just another token. We have launched this new token called Decibel Coin. How does it work? You just yell into your microphone to get money. It is, ready for the pun, it is a sound investment. Okay, let me make an NFT of the joke and sell it on OpenSea. Let's take a look at how we got here, so that we can better understand where we are headed to. We are living in what is called the information age, also known as the computer age or digital age. Humans have been through the Stone Age, the Bronze Age, yes, I'm starting from the beginning, and is in the Iron Age where technologies start being developed. I'm not saying that cavemen were building microchips, but an ongoing evolution of some rudimental technology led to what a couple of thousand years later became the Industrial Revolution. The Industrial Revolution is divided into subsets. For the developers, we're talking about arrays of arrays. So there is the first Industrial Revolution, based on steam power used to mechanize production. The second Industrial Revolution, based on electric power to achieve mass production. And the third Industrial Revolution, based on electronics used to have a smart production. And now we are in what some call the fourth Industrial Revolution, but I prefer calling it the Information Age, that is based on data, information, used as service and product. The information age is also divided in subsets. Again, for the developers, we're talking about arrays of arrays of arrays. We had the initial phase where analog content started being stored and shared in digital format. A second phase where this digital content could be sent and enjoyed over networks and eventually the internet. A third phase where services are sold and provided by individuals and companies through the internet. And the fourth phase, which has just begun, where those products and services are offered by the community to the community, the decentralization phase. Now to the point. Soon, protocol for decentralized system will start replacing those of centralized web services that currently dominate the internet. When rather than connecting to the API or some central provider, our application will interact directly with a peer-to-peer network, we will be a step into a decentralized internet. When, rather than connecting to an ISP, there is effectively a man in the middle between our computer and the rest of the internet, we will connect to a random hotspot of a global mesh network, then even the internet as infrastructure will be decentralized. There are several tools to decentralize, and blockchain is one of the prominent technologies currently used. We all know that Bitcoin, while it has the merit to have brought to us the concept of blockchain, is just one of many decentralized services that can be run on a peer-to-peer network. The adoption of blockchain is moving beyond cryptocurrency use cases. This is happening because blockchain protocols are open and anyone can implement on top of them, clone them, modify them, and most importantly, make them better. Here is a quote from Fred Ashram. Blockchain are digital organisms. As organisms evolve through changes in their DNA, blockchain protocols evolve through changes in their code. And like biological organisms, the most adaptive blockchains will be the one that survive and thrive. Please note that we're talking about bottom layer blockchain platforms, not the application developed on top of them. The need to evolve is big. Most blockchain technologies, consensus system, transaction types are thought of with the cryptocurrency in mind. This goes down to the core of how a blockchain is secured, making this platform weak and prone to attacks if adopted on non-cryptocurrency related use cases, or when managing titles of a value higher of the blockchain internal economy. In simple terms, those blockchains are secure until the return of investment of a cost of an attack makes the attack viable. For example, using current consensus systems, blockchains that are susceptible to attacks are those that manage title worth much more than the blockchain owned market cap. For example, ownership title like warehouse receipts. And those used to decentralize the management of data with no real need of a cryptocurrency. For example, documentation flow, such as medical records. To decentralize and be really decentralized, a blockchain should have no administrator, no central controller authority, or even no influential charismatic leadership. In a blockchain, each user owns and controls their data. The blockchain replaced the need to trust a third party with the cryptographical proof of what happened, when it did happen, and the guarantee that it did happen following the protocol rules hard-coded in the blockchain core software. A transaction that does not respect the rules is not processed. I cannot send them Bitcoin if I don't have them. Blockchain must be seen as a decentralized system with tools to cryptographically secure data transformation. Blockchain provides the possibility of having scarcity and thus even the singularity of digital assets, something that in the digital world was impossible just a decade ago. Blockchain makes it possible to reach a consensus about the current state of a piece of data without having to trust any third party to tell us what the current state of the piece of data is. Blockchain has the potential in the near future to fundamentally change how we share information, buy and sell things, and interact with each other and with the institution. We will use blockchain to prove our identity and even verify the authenticity of everything, from the food we eat to the medicines we take. And most importantly, people will own and control the data that belongs to them. We all know the hidden layer technology, think databases, are often the hardest for users to relate with, as they're invisible to them. This is a problem for blockchain as well, and its adoption has been made worse due to the often negative association with illicit activity allegedly done with cryptocurrencies. A good narrative is necessary to accelerate blockchain adoption and gain the needed trust for technology to be accepted in multiple industries. Furthermore, blockchain is like the new cloud, big data, or artificial intelligence. Too many people are using it as a buzzword without even knowing what they're talking about. Blockchain should be used to solve real problems, but unfortunately, it is often forced in projects without a real need for it, just for marketing purposes. A real working decentralized system has no centralized ownership or point of control, and it belongs to the people running its peer-to-peer network nodes. Companies that create a real decentralized system hand them over to the public, remaining with no control over it, besides maybe owning a big chunk of its economy. The node application code is in the hands of the open source community, and the full project is public. Once the system is public and its code is open source, then the project is really decentralized. The public members who support the funding of the project directly contribute to the development process done by the open source community. Those that run a node of the system, peer-to-peer network, are contributing to the system itself by running the network, creating collective value, and strengthening the system. They should be monetizing from the user activities. When users pay for a service consuming the peer-to-peer network, those payments should be split among the peer-to-peer node owners. Node operators need in fact to be compensated for the processing power and cost which they have allocated to run their nodes. Current system reward only the accounts that create the new blocks, while the rest of the network remain uncompensated. The way to go is reversed. Punish the accounts that do not create a block when they should. Let's pay attention. I'm not saying that there should be no way or opportunity for businesses to monetize on decentralized services. What I've been talking about until now is the lower layer, the blockchain platform itself, which needs to be really decentralized. Yet, decentralized application built on top of an open and public blockchain may have a central point of control, an administrative account, user levels, and specific monetization method. There is a world of services to be implemented and that are being implemented, starting from hybrid apps, they use blockchain just for some of their processes, to DAOs, applications that are fully working on the blockchain. Many of these decentralized systems will replace existing online services and applications, but others are new and will never have to have the chance to exist if a decentralized platform to run them didn't exist. Blockchain, and more widely decentralization, offer great opportunities, and we need to focus on and use those when deploying your project. Let me tell you the story of what I believe is one of the biggest missed opportunities when it comes to decentralization in recent history. We all know what Torrent is, right? I'm sure none of you has ever done this, but Torrent is a peer-to-peer protocol for a network mostly used to download pirated movies and music. Well, Torrent is decentralized in its nature as it is a peer-to-peer network and is the first file sharing system authorities have not been able to shut down. Torrent is at the basis of what a blockchain is today. A blockchain cannot be shut down if it runs on a solid protocol. As I'm heading to the end of this talk, as promised, I leave you with an interesting story. Title: The Missed Opportunity of the Music and Movie Industry. Consumers always bought music and movies, and those with a more criminal mind made copies of the music cassettes and VHS tapes to their families and friends. This behavior was tolerated as the loss of quality of the audio and video in analog copies made the chain of copies of copies of copies quite short. Flashback to the beginning of the speech. As we enter the first phase of the information era and content became digital, people start making copies of CDs and DVDs. At this point, there is no loss of quality, as digital copies are as good as the original. For this reason, digital copies were much less tolerated. But it gets worse. Huge drama, screaming, people running desperately in the corridor of the music and movie industry office, management pulling air off their heads. I'm just guessing. As soon as we enter the second phase of the information era, and digital content can now be copied over the internet. The music and movie industry lobbied the government to shut down any website, forum, and online file storage that was used to trade pirate content. Napster has been the last to stand. The music industry litigation worked against them, and Napster was served with an injunction and shut down its server in 2001. But then Torrent came along, a peer-to-peer network that simply cannot be stopped. The music and movie industry, now together with the software industry, as software piracy over peer-to-peer network were also rampant, lobbied the government to arrest the final users, calling them pirates. Under the US law, IP infringement may result in up to 5 years imprisonment and $250,000 fine per item copied. While copying one song or a movie counted as one infringement, illegally downloading Microsoft Windows, for example, meant an infringement for each application in it, the calculator application, the notepad, the solitaire game, and so on. Young kids end up with multiple life sentences just for downloading pirate software over the torrent. Now I ask myself, did this move made by the music, movie, and software industry accomplish to stop piracy over the peer-to-peer network? No. Did the movie and music industry gain the sympathy of the general public, making arrest of little kids? No. They were too focused fighting the wine mills. If you don't get the analogy, go read the Don Quixote, a novel by Miguel de Cervantes. and they missed what I believe was a great opportunity. The possibility to sell all the ever-created content everywhere in the planet, from big cities to the smallest village in remote countries, through a network they didn't even have to manage or pay for. They just needed to share via torrent, DRM, digital rights management, locked content, provide free preview and the means to pay them to unlock the DRM content. They had the perfect way to serve and they missed it. As Bitcoin and we did the blockchain came along a few years later, they disrupted the industry. It wasn't the one of the music and film, but the world financial sector. I'm glad that this time the reaction has been different. As we see, there is support for innovation in the financial sector when it comes to blockchain. So let's surf this magic wave all together, as there are tons of opportunity and we have a lot of work to do. Thank you for listening. Till the next time. Heart and you will feel proud. Save it in the blockchain, share it with the world. Permanent.